It is a pleasure to be here. I have long wanted to travel. This is my first opportunity to be at Oakwood University. Privileged to be here. My students at the seminary all speak in such glowing terms of their experience that they had here with many of you. Ellen Harmon, who of course with only within 3 years would become Ellen White, began her prophetic ministry at a time when the question of slavery and its continued existence and or expansion was foremost on the national agenda. The purpose of this paper is to explore Ellen White's views on slavery, the Fugitive Slave Act, Harper's Ferry, and the Civil War in order to determine the form of abolitionism she was promoting through her prophetic voice. To make this determination, it is necessary to explore the historical context in which she lived and did ministry. In 1846, there were only two distinct forms of abolitionism. There were colonizationist and Garrisonian abolitionist. And I'm going to skip through a lot here through this historical section. I'm just going to give some highlights as we move through so we can get to the more substantial parts of asking this question of where Ellen White stood on the issue. The American Colonization Society, the ACS, was founded in 1816 with such illustrious charter members as Henry Clay and John Randolph, but perhaps more importantly, William Lloyd Garrison, Arthur Tappan, James Birney, and Gerrit Smith were all colonizationists before becoming more radical abolitionists and some of the ACS's bitterest opponents. The Constitution adopted by the ACS on December 28, 1816, stated that the sole purpose of the society was to, quote, promote and execute a plan for colonization of, and then in parentheses with their consent, the free people of color residing in our country to Africa or such other place as Congress shall deem expedient. However, there was a seedier motivator behind their ideology, which was their belief in the superiority of whites and the inferiority of blacks. Many of its members believed that equality among whites and blacks was not possible or desirable in America. In their view, black men and women were sons and daughters of Africa and should be returned to the continent where God had destined them to live. Even the eventual move of the society towards a policy of gradual emancipation was palatable to these moderates in both the North and the South, because the suggested emancipation was not only gradual, but also was to be compensated and contingent upon the colonization of all emancipated slaves. The influence of the ACS was far-reaching. Abraham Lincoln was a firm, if not enthusiastic, believer in colonization. Lincoln likely inherited his views from his hero and mentor, Henry Clay, and the Whig Party. In the midst of his 1858 campaign to be an Illinois senator, Lincoln asserted, quote, "I am not in favor of Negro citizenship or bringing social and political equality. Physical difference forbids these two races living together." He advocated for the separation of the races and believed that, again, quote, "the only perfect preventative of amalgamation is colonization." From 1858 until he was sworn in as President of the United States in 1860, his favorable views regarding colonization did not undergo any substantial material change. Although the ACS's influence stretched from its inception in 1816 into the first 3 years of Lincoln's presidency, they were not without their bitter enemies. And I skip down to the last paragraph, yet the fiercest opposition to the ACS came from some of their former members, in particular William Lloyd Garrison. In 1832, Garrison's publication of Thoughts on American Colonization marked his break from the ACS and a major shift in the abolitionist movement. In his publication, Garrison was able to undermine the ideological foundation of the ACS and bring its underlining racism and elitism into light. Before the rise of Garrisonian abolitionism, there was almost complete unity in support of the ACS in Methodists, Presbyterians, Congregationalists, and Baptist churches. However, from 1831 to 1845, the New England churches began to shift their position. In particular, many Northern Methodists began flocking towards Garrisonian abolitionism. Those who broke from the ACS saw clearly the fundamental difference between Garrisonian abolitionism and the ACS. The former saw slavery as an evil that must be immediately eradicated, while the latter saw it as a problem to be solved. Thus, from 1832 onward, there were now two distinct forms of abolitionism: the moderates, who were committed to the ACS, and the radicals, who followed Garrison. William Lloyd Garrison was not the first voice, however, for a more militant form of abolitionism. In September 1829, David Walker, a free black man living in Boston, published an essay which was the strongest condemnation of slavery ever published in the United States. In fact, listen to his clarion call to America to repent or face judgment. Oh, Americans, Americans, I call God, I call angels, I call men to witness that your destruction is at hand and will be speedily consummated unless you repent. Down to the bottom paragraph on page 5, Garrisonian abolitionism was deeply rooted in a biblical theology that identified slavery not only as a sin, but as an egregious sin. Like all sin, the sin of slavery must be immediately repented of, and as an evil, it must be immediately eradicated. This brought them into direct conflict not only with the South, but also with many of the Northern churches whose members held divergent opinions regarding slavery. And now, understand, we're talking about churches now not in the South, but churches in the North. Many members of churches in the North were just absolutely pro-slavery. Others saw slavery as morally neutral and believed that the choice was a personal one, while others viewed slavery as sin but were against any kind of, quote, immediate or direct action, believed in general and gradual emancipation, and resented anti-slavery disturbers of the status quo. They also saw, Garrisonian abolitionists, they also saw another issue that needed to be addressed in the Northern churches. The egregious sin of slavery was inextricably linked to Northern racism. The complete eradication of the former would require the complete repudiation of the latter. Historians refer to Garrison's new form of abolitionism in various terms. Some refer to it as radical abolitionism, while others labeled it militant abolitionism. Whatever term is used, Garrisonian abolitionism was considered extreme even in the northern states. The Fugitive Slave Act of 1850 would push some of the Garrisonian abolitionists to an even more extreme form of abolitionism involving, quote, direct confrontation, disunionism, and violence to make their voices heard. Eventually, it would lead to the formation of the Radical Political Abolition Party. On September 18, 1850, when the act was passed, it led on June 26 to 28 of 1855 a gathering of frustrated Garrisonian abolitionists who gathered for a convention in Syracuse. Ultimately, the convention led to the formation of a new political party, the Radical Political Abolition Party. The party's platform embraced the following tenets: One, it is the duty of the federal government to protect human rights. Two, slavery is anti-constitutional. Three, the immediate general emancipation of slaves. And four, the use of violence as a method to end slavery. It was their willingness to use violence that marked a big break with Garrisonian abolitionism. In fact, the willingness of the RPAP to embrace and use violence would lead Garrison himself to conclude that they were, quote, madmen. However, there was something else that distinguished this abolitionist party from the Garrisonian abolitionist. It was an unprecedented movement of interracial unity. The party's top leadership core consisted of two free blacks, James McEwen Smith and Frederick Douglass, and two whites, Garrett Smith and John Brown. The interracial unity that existed in the party was based on its theological understanding of the fusion of body and soul. The logical conclusion of this theological tenet was that blacks and whites were not just equal on the level of their souls, but they were fully equal in all ways. The end result was that they, quote, treated blacks with a far greater degree of equality and respect than other abolitionist organizations. Now, though ultimately this party would accomplish little to nothing politically, it did start a spark that would ultimately ignite in John Brown's raid on Harper's Ferry. The complete embodiment of the RPAP was John Brown. Brown truly believed that everyone, irrespective of his or her skin color, was created in God's image. Thus, everyone, regardless of skin tone, were brothers and sisters. For Brown, this was not just a theoretical belief. Among all the white participants in the abolitionist movement, he and his family were unique in the way that they rejected any sense of white superiority. Apthicker notes that Brown's, quote, hatred of slavery reflected his own rejection of racism and elitism. Brown not only deeply embraced equality, he also embraced militancy. He believed that slavery was rooted in violence and that therefore physical resistance by or on behalf of slaves was not only just, but necessary. After his arrest and his conviction of treason, on the way to the gallows, John Brown handed a handwritten note to one of the prison guards that said, "I, John Brown, am now quite certain that the crimes of this guilty land will never be purged away but with blood. I had, as I now think, vainly flattered myself that without very much bloodshed, it might be done." His words would turn out to be prophetic. Ultimately, slavery would only be purged from the land through the bloodletting of the Civil War, even though emancipation was not at the core of the Civil War. Although Lincoln's presidency is primarily defined by his executive order, the Emancipation Proclamation that he issued on January 1, 1863, a much greater portion of his presidency was focused on black colonization. I'll skip through a little bit of the history of that, but following two disastrous attempts at colonization on Lincoln's part and the part of his administration, the policy of Lincoln's administration morphed significantly with the dawn of 1863. However, this change of policy was not driven primarily by a commitment to end slavery. As Fox argues, Lincoln undoubtedly opposed slavery, but the evidence seems conclusive that he emancipated the slaves not out of his hatred of slavery, but out of his love for the Union. He offers as evidence Lincoln's own words. Lincoln was unequivocal in his position, quote, "I would save the Union if there be those who would not save the Union unless they can at the same time destroy slavery. I do not agree with them. My paramount object in the struggle is to save the Union, and it is not either to save or destroy slavery. What I do about slavery and the colored race, I do because I believe that it helps to save the Union. Clearly, the preservation of the Union was Lincoln's paramount concern. Another issue that just sparked the furor of radical abolitionists was the federal government's vacillating policy regarding what to do with slaves who escaped the federal line to the federal line, further inflamed the anger of the Garrisonian abolitionists. The Garrisonian abolitionists demanded a clear and better policy for dealing with fugitive slaves. Ellen White would use her prophetic office to respond to the pressing issues of slavery, the Fugitive Slave Act of 1850, it should say there, and the Civil War. Her voice, primarily through her pen, offers a picture of the type of abolitionist thought she was promoting. I turn first to slavery. Ellen White's views on slavery were unequivocal. She proclaimed that slavery is, in the sight of heaven, is a sin of the darkest dye, and, quote, proceeded from the dominion of Satan. Like Garrisonian abolitionists, White's views were deeply rooted in a biblical theology that identified slavery not only as a sin, but a dark, egregious sin. Like all sin, the sin of slavery must be immediately repented of and eradicated. In Walker's 1829 essay, previously noted as the strongest condemnation of slavery ever published in the United States, he had called for God and the angels to witness the slaves rising up and ripping off their shackles of slavery. In equally strong terms, Ellen White spoke about the witness of God and the angels. She stated that heaven beholds with indignation this enormous and grievous sin. Angels have recorded it all. It is written in the book. His wrath burns against this nation and especially against the religious bodies that have sanctioned this terrible traffic and have themselves engaged in it. Heaven did not have to be called to witness the evil of slavery, she was stating. All heaven was witnessing it with indignation. Heavenly angels were recording it all in the books. She also notes the method by which the angels were recording it in the book. Quote, the names of the oppressors are written in blood, crossed with stripes and flooded with agonizing, burning tears of suffering. The book she's alluding to is the Book of Remembrance. She identifies this book in her writings as the place where, quote, all the deeds of men is kept. All good actions, all the evil actions are recorded. She then identifies the book's primary role. All sin will be revealed in the day of judgment. Unless they have been repented of beforehand, they will receive punishment according to their magnitude. While the angels record the egregious sin, she states that God's wrath burns against it. In particular, his wrath burns against America, and even more so against the religious bodies that have either sanctioned slavery or participated in it. In fact, she made it clear that God's fury would not cease until he had caused this land to drink the dregs of the cup of his fury. Similar to Garrisonian abolitionists, White's views that slavery was a sin and her message calling for the immediate eradication of this evil would have placed her in conflict not only with the South, but also with many of the Northern churches and their divergent opinions regarding slavery. Ellen White's message was clear and direct to churches and church members that were either pro-slavery or enablers of slavery. She referred to those in these religious bodies as merely, quote, professed followers of the meek and lowly Jesus. She went on to declare that worship offered by such individuals is a solemn mockery. Satan exalts over it and reproaches Jesus and his angels, saying with hellish triumph, such are Christ's followers. According to Ellen White, no true follower of Jesus could sanction or participate in slavery, and anyone who did should not dare worship God. Her response was swift and direct when she discovered that there was a proponent of slavery in the Adventist movement. In a personal letter sent to Brother A, she made clear that he was, quote, in league with a, quote, degraded and God-forsaken company, and that, quote, the angels of God had fled from him in disgust. She then laid out an appropriate response to a religious body that to any pro-slavery person in their midst. It will be the duty of God's people to publicly withdraw their fellowship from you. We must let it be known that we have no such one in our fellowship, that we will not walk with them in church capacity. Ellen White makes it clear that the church bears the responsibility to disfellowship any members that were pro-slavery. The Fugitive Slave Act of 1850, as I mentioned earlier, pushed some of the Garrisonian abolitionists to an even more extreme form of abolitionism involving direct confrontation, disunionism, and violence to make their voices heard. The response of Ellen White to this new law was to issue a prophetic call for civil disobedience. And I'll let you read the larger quote that's there, but Ellen White reacted very strongly to the Fugitive Slave Act of 1850 that required citizens of the United States to return to their masters or runaway slaves as their rightful property. Refusal to do so meant a person could be prosecuted for aiding and abetting a fugitive slave. Such a law for Ellen White was clearly in opposition to the higher laws of God. She was unequivocal in her statement that this law we are not to obey, and that Adventists should be ready and willing to suffer the consequences of violating this law. In her argument against the Fugitive Slave Act, she also clearly attacks, at least I believe so in her words, she also clearly attacks the Supreme Court's Dred Scott decision of 1857 that declared slaves to be the personal property of their masters. For Ellen White, slaves were not property of any man. God is the master of all. And no one has the right to take what belongs to God and claim it as their own. One thing that distinguished the radical political abolitionist party from Garrisonian abolitionism was its unprecedented interracial unity. On the issue of racial equality, Ellen White's views were much more in harmony with those of the RPAP. Her deep-seated belief in racial equality emerged primarily from two scriptural grand narratives. First, she pointed to the cross and the fact that Christ died for the whole human family, whether white or black. The view of equality at the cross was not a point of controversy amongst abolitionists. Garrisonian abolitionists, as well as some colonizationists, embraced the argument that Christ's redemptive act on the cross upholds the equality of all souls, regardless of color. It was Ellen's second biblical argument for racial equality that would have put her at odds with the Garrisonian abolitionist and more in step with the RPAP view of equality. She argued that Christ is both creator and redeemer of all. Expanding her argument from redemption to creation led her to the same logical conclusion that the RPAP had made. Blacks and whites were not just equal on the level of their souls, but they were fully equal in all ways. F.C. Gilbert cites John Loughborough as his source for a story that offers some interesting insight into the reaction of Ellen White when informed about John Brown's unsuccessful raid on Harper's Ferry. It should be noted that I've not been able to find any documentation in the writings of Ellen White or those of John Loughborough that collaborates the story. So I share the story with this caveat. However, there are a number of things that may lend credence to the story. Gilbert was highly regarded by both Ellen G. White and other Seventh-day Adventist leaders of her day, making it somewhat unlikely that he would fabricate a story. Additionally, it is highly plausible that Ellen G. White and her associates would have discussed John Brown in Harper's Ferry. After all, Brown was a topic of conversation in numerous editions of the Adventist Review and Sabbath Herald between 1859 and 1860. All of the articles about Brown were positive and expressed some degree of sympathy for him and his cause. The same sentiments were expressed by Ellen White towards Brown in Gilbert's story. In November 1859, John Loughborough was requested by James and Ellen White to meet them in Detroit for their return trip to the East. Before leaving Michigan, they acquired a newspaper and in it read the story of John Brown and his failed raid at Harper's Ferry. Most of those in the traveling party laughed about such a crazy scheme as Brown's. Ellen White, though, was quick to bring an end to their laughter and their ridicule of John Brown. She declared, "Brown's motives in the movement were all right. His sympathies were aroused for the cruel treatment of slaves. That led him to make the move he did to secure for them what our Declaration says all men are entitled to, liberty. John Brown's raid was not for plunder or for murder." She then went on to predict, like John Brown had done on the way to the gallows, that before the end of slavery, there would be more made of this country, there would be more blood required of this country on a much greater scale than that of John Brown's for the liberating of the slaves. In her words to Loughborough and others in the party traveling with her, Ellen White appears to be sympathetic to John Brown and his forceful attempt to end slavery. She notes that his motives were all right. Now, this is not meant to imply that Ellen G. White was advocating the use of violence. However, it does express the fact that she is in full agreement with his dire prediction that the crimes of this guilty land will never be purged away, but with blood. In harmony with this statement, she makes her own prediction of something soon to take place in this country on a much greater scale than that of John Brown's for the liberating of the slaves. The dire predictions of John Brown and Ellen White came to fruition with the outbreak of the Civil War on April 12, 1861. As the war progressed, Lincoln's focus on preserving the Union and his reluctance to move towards emancipation caused Ellen White to declare that, quote, "many were blinded and grossly deceived in the last election, and their influence was used to place in authority men who would wink at evil." Garrisonian abolitionists were beginning to wonder if they had supported and elected the wrong candidates. According to Ellen White, they did not have to wonder. They had elected wrong men. Like Garrisonian abolitionists, the federal government's vacillating policy regarding what to do with slaves who escaped to the federal line outraged Ellen White. She said, quote, "I was shown how our leading men have treated the poor slaves that have come to them for protection. Angels have recorded it. Great men professing to have human hearts have seen the slaves almost naked and starving and sent them back to their cruel masters and hopeless bondage." The appalling response of the Northern military commanders to the desperate plight of escaping slaves was the primary reason Ellen White rejected the call for national days of fasting and prayer for God to bring the war to a speedy conclusion. She proclaimed that such national fasts were an insult to Jehovah, and their prayers were disgusting to God. The fast God desired was to loose the bands of wickedness, to undo the heavy burdens, and to set the oppressed free. Only when this was accomplished would God accept their prayers as far as the war is concerned. The first national fast that the Seventh-day Adventist Church felt they could participate in was the one appointed for April 30, 1863. Almost 4 months earlier, President Lincoln had signed the Emancipation Proclamation. Adventists felt that they could participate because finally the government was beginning to walk in harmony with Isaiah 58. She was also very clear on what God was doing to the nation through the Civil War. God is punishing this nation for the high crime of slavery. He has the destiny of the nation in his hands. He will punish the South for the sin of slavery and the North for so long suffering its overreaching and overbearing influence. Ultimately, she predicted that the war would not end until God, quote, had caused the land of light to drink in the dregs of his cup of fury. For Ellen White, the Civil War was divine judgment for the terrible crime of slavery. An exploration of the teachings of Ellen White in regard to slavery, the Fugitive Slave Act, Harper's Ferry, and the Civil War suggests that Ellen White could be classified as a radical abolitionist. To be clear, there is no evidence that she ever joined any abolitionist society or political party. However, the views she so strongly expressed position her on a middle ground between the American Abolition Society and the radical political abolition party. Like both the ASS and the RPAP, Ellen White was not merely opposed to the expansion of slavery, she was opposed to its very existence and saw it clearly as a satanic institution and a terrible sin. She believed strongly that any Adventist that held pro-slavery views should be disfellowshipped. Similar to some Garrisonian abolitionists, the Fugitive Slave Act pushed Ellen White to a more extreme form of abolitionism and a prophetic call to civil disobedience, believing God's laws were more important than the laws of men. She told people it was their duty to defy this law and that they should be willing to face any consequences that came from such disobedience. Her advocacy for civil disobedience was not as extreme as the RPAP's movement towards the use of violence to end slavery. However, it was further than some and perhaps most Garrisonian abolitionists were willing to go. Ellen White's was a stronger proponent of racial equality than many Garrisonian abolitionists. Foundational to her belief was Christ is both creator and redeemer of all. Thus, by virtue of creation and redemption, blacks and whites were equal in every way. John Brown and the RPAP would have embraced her position. Unlike Garrison, who viewed John Brown as, quote, a madman, Ellen White seemingly served as an apologist for John Brown after his failed raid at Harper's Ferry. Again, her words of sympathy for John Brown and his cause do not imply that she was advocating violence. It does express her hatred for the sin of slavery and reflects a growing understanding that before slavery was brought to an end, more blood would be shed. In the Civil War, she saw God's hand and judgment upon the South and the North for the horrific institution of slavery. While she saw the South at fault for their continuing to propagate the institution of slavery, she was in no way willing to excuse the North. The North had simply not done enough to bring slavery to an end. In a time when even in Northern churches, there was little support for radical abolitionists, Ellen White made it clear where she stood. She was the prophetic voice of radical abolitionism.